Amazon, as you know, has done a lot of work in the online world, and we are setting the standard for what constitutes convenience. Our challenge when we started the physical retail organization was, what is our unique spin on convenience in a physical environment? My name is Dilip Kumar. I'm a vice president in our physical retail organization, and I've been at Amazon for the past 18 years. I was Jeff Bezos' technical advisor for a couple of years. And when this notion of physical stores started way back when in 2012, I was one of three people who was chartered with figuring out how do you make physical stores different and convenient for customers. When we launched physical retail, our first product that we launched was Just Walk Out. That led to the Amazon Dash Cart, which again was another way for us to provide convenience for customers to skip the checkout line. But while that was all focused towards skipping the checkout line, there was another parallel initiative that was brewing because there were many retailers which had point of sale and customers were still waiting in line. So our primary impetus for developing Amazon One was to find ways to speed up the process of customers having to not have to wait in line even if there was a point of sale. Amazon One is a fast, convenient, contactless way for customers to identify, enter, and pay in any physical environment. So once we wanted to create Amazon One, there was a range of biometrics that we could choose from. Face, voice, fingerprints. We selected palm because it had several characteristics that were very suitable for us. The first one was we wanted it to be contactless. Now, several biometrics met that criteria. The second criteria that was very important for us is that we wanted the biometric to be private. When you look at a palm, you can't ascertain a person's physical identity by just looking at a picture of their palm. Unlike face or even your voice, which can give you clues about the person's identity, a picture of your palm doesn't give you a clue as to who the person is. Third one was we wanted this to be a very intentional gesture. What makes a very simple, intuitive gesture for customers? That's where we started. People are used to holding a phone over a scanner in order to be able to identify themselves. So we said, well, let's remove the phone. People are used to this gesture of holding something over a scanner, so we can just eliminate the phone from that and just have people hover their palm over it. It wasn't a passive biometric, like your mere walking into the room or standing in line doesn't trigger a biometric to, you know, be identified. So we want the customer to always be in control over where and when they choose to either identify or to pay. And the last one, which is very important for any biometric, is if the biometric is inaccurate, if it doesn't actually do the job of being able to identify the person, then it's not a very suitable biometric. And we felt that the palm and the vein were very suitable biometrics, but that also required us to do a lot of research to get to that stage to make it a suitable biometric. Then the question was that how do we assemble the right set of skills necessary for it. The first one was the hardware or the device itself. Now, in order to be able to capture the right kind of details from the palm, as well as the subsurface images of the vein, it involved very sophisticated camera and optics that we needed to build in order to be able to get to the right level of sophistication. From a software perspective, we wanted this to be extremely intuitive and very easy for customers to understand. All a customer needs to do is come in and hover their palm over the device. But we needed our software to be very quick. We needed an ability to provide customers guidance on where they needed to hold their palm over the device. And we needed to be able to figure out the identification tasks of knowing who the customer is in a very, very small period of time. That provided a huge amount of challenges, not just for the software side, but also the research side, because the research was all about figuring out how do you take two different biometrics, the palm, the surface characteristics that you can actually see on your hand, as well as the subsurface characteristics that are just below the surface, the vein structure, and how do you use a combination of those two to triangulate to figure out and have very high accuracy for this biometric. Unlike face or voice, which has plenty of data available in order to train computer vision algorithms, there wasn't any publicly available data sets for palm. So we had to create our own. Now, one of the challenges that computer vision algorithms in general face, and it's not specific to biometrics, is unequal representation of data can cause biases in the algorithms. So for us, we had to create synthetic data to create subtle variations in your palm and vein structure and to be able to train our algorithms with millions and millions of data points without requiring millions and millions of physical customers using the device. In order to do that, we created these artifacts in our lab, which allowed us to figure out very quickly what constitutes a sharp image. A sharp image referring to, are we getting all the detail necessary for us to be able to separate one palm and vein from another palm and vein? And how does that vary based on how far a person holds their palm over it, whether it's cold, whether it's hot, whether it's belonging to different times of the day? There's a variety of different things that cause your palm and vein structure to change over time. We wanted to be able to capture those subtle differences. And in order to do that, we build these motorized testers that use a spatial frequency response as a metric to determine whether is this a good image quality that's necessary for us in order to be able to identify this palm if you are hovering it over for just a fraction of a second. The problem with palm and vein data is that you want your synthetic data to be realistic enough so that your algorithms don't get confused by things that are never seen in anybody's palm or never seen in any vein structure. Because adding more of that just adds noise. It doesn't help. So it needs to be realistic, but it needs to be separate enough, and it needs to be driven off of the specific characteristics of the palm and vein for the different subsegments in order for us to be able to boost enough data for each of these separate areas so that we can get our overall accuracy up. We look at things where we are unable to identify the person or we misidentify the person. And our misidentification rate so far has been zero. We'd rather be in the position of not being able to identify in case we don't have adequate details rather than misidentify. So we skew and bias our algorithms to say that it's okay to not identify and ask for other forms of identification rather than make a misidentification. But when you're building an identity and payment biometric service, security was even just as important, if not job number one. We had tamper detection and intrusion detection on the device itself. If the device gets misplaced, it gets lost, it gets stolen, there's nothing stored locally on it. Everything is encrypted. We don't accept raw biometrics. Only biometrics that have been generated by the device and are attested by the device and can talk to mutually authenticated endpoints in the cloud are the only ones that are allowed. So while we have an end-to-end encryption, we also have the ability where we shut down only the set of things that are necessary to talk to the device are the only ones that are even allowed to talk to the device. For any payment device, we have to go through third-party certifications that indicate the level of security and the confidence and the assurance for both, not just for us, but for also customers that it's adhering to the level that customers expect from any identity and payment service. One of the other things that we did to boost the security of the device is something known as liveness detection. We needed to know if someone is holding a live hand over it or if it's an artificial or a silicon hand. And so we created multiple different artifacts of silicon hands to be able to figure out what is the difference between a fake hand as well as something where you have a live hand where you can actually see the blood flow in the vein structure. There's a variety of things that you can do to identify a fake hand from a silicon hand. And so we built testers to not just identify that, but we also be able to identify things like sometimes people come in with dirt on their hands or there's other tattoos, there's other kinds of marks. So you can actually determine a variety of different things in order to figure out how to boost the overall accuracy and the security of the system. So security is something that we built into this device, built into our software, built into all our processes from day one. Customers have loved the experience. They've loved how simple and easy it is to use, and it saves them time when they're waiting in line. There's many different ways in a physical environment where one has to stop, one has to identify themselves, one has to pay either for loyalty or for paying your bills, whatever those cases might be. Amazon One is uniquely positioned to be the way that customers identify, enter, or pay in a variety of different environments, which is secure, it is fast, it's convenient, and it's effortless for customers. We're building complex products, but our challenge isn't just the complexity of building it, it's to make this complexity recede from customers so that when they come in and hover their palm over it, that's the only thing that they have to do, and then we take care of all the complexity behind the scenes. And I tend to focus a lot on the simplification aspects of it because simplification helps us create very intuitive and very easy to understand experiences for customers. You know, humans don't like to subtract. Humans love addition. They like to add features. It feels like that they're adding value. But sometimes the simplicity of taking things away is just as powerful. And while it increases the challenge for us, it resulted in a great experience and a very simple experience for customers when they came in to pay.